regard to the SDGs and the link 10 with the link with TB elimination and control, we are having multiple sessions here at this conference on the issue on TB and migration, because we believe that many of the missed cases that we are missing every year, around 3 million people who are healed with tuberculosis but are not diagnosed or not reported in the systems, maybe come, you know, from the hundreds of millions of refugees, internally displaced persons, and migrants in general. They could be documented migrants or undocumented migrants. TB has no border, and we want to support the idea that we have borders, unfortunately, for people in the world, but TB has no border, and we should treat TB everywhere and for anyone, and leave no one behind. So what we are trying to do is to, during this conference, we are having a workshop. Actually, we had a workshop yesterday morning. It was well attended with 85 delegates, where we had group works and asking the delegates who attended the workshop what would be their recommendations for a position statement that we would like the union to push forward to the international community on TB and migration. So we were working in around three axes, one around the standardizing the treatment and approaches to TB control. The other axis was to share data and information, especially in the context of cross-border or even within one country, like India, for example, how you share data and information, of course, with the respect of confidentiality of the patients, so that, you know, there is a continuum of treatment and care. And the last axis was on funding. We heard a lot from the delegates at the workshop yesterday how difficult it is to find funding when you want to work with migrants or refugees, the lack of flexibility of donors sometimes who cannot really respond fast to a crisis. We have the Syria crisis at the moment, with millions of Syrians going to neighboring countries, Lebanon and Jordan especially, and Turkey. So how we work around the three axes and then summarize them into a position statement that we want the union to move forward. Our strategy is to move with the union and through the union, because the union so far was the only organization giving us this platform to exchange on TB and migration. And the union came up with the first statement on TB and migration around 10 years ago, where the union declared that you should not deport anyone while on TB treatment, even if this is a non-documented migrant, irregular migrant, it doesn't matter. What matters first is health, and so you want the person to be cured successfully from TB. So the link is on the undiagnosed, but also we believe that when the migrants are diagnosed with TB, there is a lot of issues around continuity of care. Who will support the TB treatment for a refugee, for a migrant? The host country, the international donors, there's a lot of commotion around this. Nobody wants to pay for the migrants. So continuity of care is an issue. And we're also, of course, advocating on the TB and migration, which will benefit overall the, you know, the development goal around TB elimination, because we also need cheaper diagnostic tools, rapid diagnostic tools, and cheaper drugs for MDR-TB. And MDR-TB also around the TB migration is quite big. We unfortunately don't have lots of data around it, but we can, of course, anticipate that there will be a lot of MDR-TB in this community due to their, you know, them being forced to move from one place to the other, interrupting the treatment, etc. So this is a commitment, so yes. from those signatories, yes. We had commitments in the past, yes, which never materialized. Mm-hmm. But anyway, what we are going to do here is really trying to push the change of mentality. We have a symposium this afternoon, mm-hmm, at 5:30 p.m. mm-hmm, on the issue of TB care for communities affected by conflict mm-hmm, or crisis situations. Mm-hmm. And we will have an interesting panel with the donors, the policymakers, the governments, and of course the communities. Mm-hmm. We have also the honor to have a Syrian refugee who left Syria to Jordan with his family of four kids and his wife, who got TB, who actually had TB symptoms for 2 years before he got diagnosed. Because of fear of deportation, because of fear of discrimination, because of lack of funding, he was denying the TB symptoms for a long time, and finally got diagnosed and treated in Jordan, and successfully. So we want to show, you know, that it's possible, that there needs to be some flexibility from the donor side. But donors is not alone here, you know, domestic funding is important. Yes. And of course, when countries like Lebanon and Jordan receive these really huge numbers of refugees, sometimes it's difficult for them also. So then the international community must commit to pay, you know, for the cost of the migrants. Because like you said, the migrants contribute to the economy, they contribute to the life of the host countries where they are going. And we have also to destroy the myth around the migrants that they are a burden and they are disease carriers, you know. It's not true. All the statistics show that most of the migrants are actually very healthy because they are normally young people and very productive in the host country and cost much less than what they actually generate for the host country, and also, like you said, for the country where they come from. So we really hope that we are going anyway to try our best to really push this commitment from the donor community side, from the, of course, with the support of all the communities of migrants, and also from the policymaker and the governments, because donors are not alone here, communities are not alone. Without the policymakers and the government, you cannot achieve anything also. So that's interesting. Yesterday at the workshop, we had a presentation from Paul Douglas, who is a very good friend of this TB and migration group here. He is working for the Australian government on the immigration. And he doesn't like to call the screening of migrants a screening. He actually wants to call it active case finding. And what he said is that, according to his experience in Australia, he is convinced that when you do that, it's definitely something positive for the public health and for the individual if you consider the human rights approach. So screening to discriminate, no, it is definitely not, of course, good for the individual, it's not, and it's not even for the country, because it creates a false sentiment of safety in a country. You know, there are also many countries who still ban entry for people living with HIV, for example, which is, you know, nonsense. It has been shown in some studies. It creates a false sense of security. People hide their disease, be TB or HIV, because they are afraid. So when it's done with the objective of stigmatizing or denying access to anything, could be you know, the country even, or work or whatever, no, this has no benefits. So we need to shift that mentality. But when you do it to like Paul Douglas said, like active case finding, to really, you know, first have the individual benefit of finding someone, diagnosing TB and treating TB successfully, so for the life of the person himself. And then also it will have, you know, of course, it will be benefit also for the host country, and the community and the local community. And don't forget that, you know, something that we hear a lot in our groups and symposia around the issue on TB and migration, people have this myth that migrants will, you know, disseminate disease in the host country community. Actually, it's not true. If there are any transmission of the disease, it remains within their own community, within a subgroup in the host country. Meaning that, you know, it's also sad. So you want to protect this community. So when you do that, when you do the active case finding, because you want also to protect the community, yes, it's good, but not because you want to stop someone from entering.